Essentially, we have been studying the mechanisms and the cloud computing mechanisms, and there are four types of mechanisms we are looking at, which is cloud security, which we covered, and then cloud infrastructure, which is going on right now, and then we have specialized cloud mechanisms and cloud management mechanisms. All of this actually is part of Unit 2. So earlier I thought only infrastructure is part of Unit 2, but no, it's specialized cloud mechanisms and cloud management mechanism is also part of Unit 2. So for today, we'll try to wrap up the infrastructure mechanism, and that's all we'll be covering today. But in your next lectures, we will continue with specialized cloud mechanism and cloud management mechanism, which is part of Unit 2. Okay. So far, whatever we have covered, we have already covered cloud security mechanism, which is encryption, hashing, digital signature, digital certificate, public key, identity access management, single sign-on, security group, and hardened virtual server images. And then we have moved on to infrastructure mechanism, which was we moved on to infrastructure mechanisms, which was all about infrastructure, and then we started with logical network parameter, which is all about networks, right? So we said we have to isolate the network from the actual physical network so that we can protect the underlying physical resources, plus we can isolate one consumer from the another consumer. So they may be so they will have their own virtual private cloud within which they can create their own subnets, within which they can create their own services. So that's how the isolation is done. The services are always isolated in the private networks of the cloud consumer. If any web server is there, something that requires an internet gateway, then that network will be specifically be given a public IP address to access the, and it will be configured for internet gateway. So that network should always be separate. So in logical network parameter also, even if it is the same cloud consumer, one subnet may be used for public access, which may be outbound or inbound. So outbound would mean the people within inside the network can access the internet, and inbound would mean people outside, like your customers, they can access the website and access your web server. It is inbound. So depending on what rules that you define, accordingly that will be applied. And as I told you, security group is a kind of a rules that you define at a higher level, right? A network higher level, within like a logical network parameter, bigger network parameter. Inside that you might have private networks and public networks, where which will have a separate set of firewall rules. But at a very high level, security groups is applied to all the subnets inside a bigger network. So that is all about playing with networks, right? So where we define our, the every cloud consumer will have his own virtual private cloud, which means own logical network perimeter. Inside that they can create many subnets, right? So they can have public subnet or private subnets. Public subnet is something which will have internet access. If a private subnet wants an access to public subnet, so I don't think I've explained that part, so that part maybe I can just explain a little bit now. So let us assume this is your virtual private cloud. So you need to give a, so when you say virtual private cloud means you're going to get a set of addresses. So it may be something like 10.0.0.1/8, which means this is the last 8 bits, right? The last, see, these addresses can range, I hope you all understand, the addresses range from you know, maximum it can go up to is 255, right? Over here, something like this. So and it starts from 0.0.0.0. So which range of addresses you want, that is what you're trying to do. So this 10 point, let's say this is 0.00, right? This is the network that you're defining. So this network would contain what all addresses, you know, so 8 bits means 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8, that is 0. 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8, second 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8, 0, and the last one is 1, right? So it is 0 0 0 0 0, 5 6 7 8. This is what is this? This is 0.0. I hope this you have done. This is how, this is your decimal. Above is your binary value and below is your decimal, you know, decimal value 1. So each of them, each number is occupying 8 bits, right? So slash 8 would mean you know, in this network you can you cannot slash this 8 bits would mean that only this addresses can, you can, for new addresses, you know, this will be you know, you cannot change this value, but you can change this. So the, which means this part of the number you can change. So what all numbers can be possible with this number 0 0 0 0 4 1 2 3 1 0, right? Then the next address is possible 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 1 1. Then the next address that is possible 1 0 0. And this will keep on you know, having all combinations, right? Something like this, it will keep on going on. So your virtual private cloud, you can create machines inside, you know, so let's say there are machines, you know, 2 machines here and 2 machines here. So this, all this cannot get addresses outside this network, right? It has to be part of this numbers only, in which the first 16 bit is constant, because you can 8 bits mean last 8 bits will can change, but the first 16 bits mean, this, since this is 24 bits, you know, the last 8 bits, the first 16 bits cannot change, right? That is how it works. In this also you can create private subnet. So you can say this is a private subnet. So this is one big network. Private subnet is like your child of your bigger network, right? This is one, 2 computers will be in this network, 2 computers will be in this network. So you can say this network is 0.0.0. Let's say /4. Okay. So let's, I think this, let's make this 1. I think I must have done some mistake. So let's say sorry, not 1. Let's make this 2 bits 3 bits, right? So let's make this 0.0. So let this be 8. I hope I'm right. So what all addresses is possible in this means where /2 means last 2 bits only can be modified, right? So which means this addresses that is possible in this is 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8. Then last 2 bits only can modify, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And these two bits can modify. That is what this network, these are the addresses which the network can contain. So these are called CIDR addressing, right? This is how we address the, if you address it, if you, when you specify this slash 2, it is a CIDR. So what are possible? So this all, you know, the first two bits means only these two bits can be modified for new addresses. So what all is possible? So the first 22 bits will be constant. The first 22 bits is constant. Then what all address is possible in this? 00, 01, 10 and 11. Only 4 addresses are possible in this network, means you can create only 4 computers inside this network. But 0.0.1/2 is a part of 0.0.1/8. So definitely, right, this address is also part of this. So definitely, and that's why this is called a subnet. A subnet is the set of addresses that would map to the parent network. It should be part of that bigger number. Okay, the bigger number can, you can have a lot of more computers, but because you gave only 2 bits, only 4 computers are possible. Now in this network, I will say 0.0.1, let's say 3 bits. Okay, so this network, which means 3 bits can be modified, right? So what all addresses are possible in this network? 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8, that is first 0, second 0, 1 3 4 5 6 7 8, second 0, third 0, 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8, third 0, 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 and 1, right? This is the address. So only 3 bits and we want to make this 16, we'll have to modify this. Okay, so if it is 16 bits, then I'm just modifying, because why, you know, because this address 00001 is in this network also, right? So you cannot have the same, if there are two subnets, you cannot have the same address in both the networks. That's why I'm expanding this network to fit in more computers. So we can modify this. I may be doing some mistake possible, but I hope you understand the what is happening. So this is 1.1/3, right? So this is the address, and this I will also say this is running from 0.001 with, you can modify 16 bits, which means I can modify even this 8 bits. So now the number of computers can be this much, 2 raised to power of 16, which is like a very big number, right? It is 65536, I guess. So this network will have this address, and what will this network have? The second network, it starts from 0011, right? So the second fellow will always be, the third fellow will always be 00000678. This is how, so this addressing and this addressing, now the addresses in this network will not match, will never be occur in this subnet. So now the subnets are protected, you know, from each other. So the addressing is proper. So this subnet will, all the addresses will, so only 3 bits can modify, means, which means what? Which means last 3 bits can be modified only, right? The rest 24 minus 3 is 21, so those bits will never modify. So the addresses that are possible in this is 001 010 101 101 101 111 and 111. Right, okay, this is not able to. Is it possible? Let me. Right. Now I can fit in here. Right. So how many computers can be part of this network? Clearly we can see, where it start from? Yeah. Now how many computers can 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right? So there can be only 4 computers in this subnet, in subnet 1, and 7 computers in subnet 2. And this addresses, both these addresses are part of the bigger network, which is a VPC. This is the range, you know, where only 16 bits can be modified. In this 16 bits, in this subnet, only last 2 bits can be modified, and in this second subnet, only last 3 bits can be modified. So what we were saying is, we are defining logical parameters. If you want to protect some resources in a different subnet, you create a separate subnet. So now this could be your public subnet, that is what we were talking about. So this addressing technique is called CIDR. Okay. So this is a little bit of networks, basics of networks we are learning. But if you want to understand how networks they is protected, this is how it is done. So one is public subnet, and second is private subnet. Private subnet means nobody can access internet from the private subnet. But from the public subnet means there is a network rule which connects to your internet over here, which is called the internet gateway, right? So this network is configured, the rules are configured in such a way so that you can access the internet gateway, and through the internet gateway you can access the internet. Even this fellow can access the internet. So in this also you can have people who want to access your web server. You need to allow inbound rule. You need to give inbound, set this IP address, inbound is allowed. And if you want people from inside to access the internet, browse the internet, your employees or your students or whatever, you have to give outbound rule, that outbound is allowed and inbound is allowed. So separate rule, so you can give all both the permissions. And if you want private subnet to access the internet, then you need to have some kind of a network gateway inside this. I think it's inside the public subnet. This private subnet will be connected to internet network gateway, and this network gateway will be allowed to access the. So lot of there's too much of drawings on it. So network gateway is over here. So this network, private network, can access only the network gateway, and it will have a outbound rule. It will use the internet gateway internally to go outside. That is how your private people in the private network can go outside, but they cannot come inside. Okay, so this network gateway gives you an outbound way, but it doesn't give you a way through inbound way. Okay, so that way your what can be there in private subnet? Your private subnet can have your data, right? and this public subnet can have your website. Now, since website is something which everyone has to access in both ways, where people can access your website and you can also display information, you need inbound outbound rules with the internet gateway. And since the private subnet is your databases and files and everything, you want only the web server to give the access. So this inbound rules will only be allowed for your local subnets. So you need to define a rule again that in case if the request has to come from the public subnet, then only you will allow them to access the data over here, otherwise no. So this is what I meant, that there are public subnets and private subnets. So private subnet is equal to a subnet without internet. Public subnet is a subnet with internet access. And both these subnets, you can define how many computers or resources can be created inside this subnet using CIDR policy. And VPC is your virtual private cloud, which is nothing but your logical network parameters. In fact, subnet is also like a logical network parameters. All wherever you have a boundary defined, in this case there are three boundaries, one bigger boundary and two smaller boundaries, you can there are three logical network parameters. And ideally there will be anyone who enters your logical your bigger VPC network, you will have a security group which will be defined. This security group will have some rules who can access your bigger network, right? And so this fellow will be letting people in and out. So ideally it will be here somewhere, okay, before anyone enters in and out. Security group rules, before even somebody reaches the subnet, the security groups will be applied. If you have, and this security group rules can be applied to all the VPCs that you have created, not necessary that, so you can take these rules and say apply on this VPC 1, VPC 2, VPC 3, right? And at the resource level over here, if you have one computer over here, if you want to specifically protect this one computer, you can define what? A firewall. So firewall can be, so which color should I give? Okay, let's give this color. A firewall can be placed around that computer. So it is quite possible the security group rules may allow somebody to come in, but the firewall rule will may not allow to access the resource. Maybe the rules, because the firewall is applied on particular resource, a particular computer. So you can protect. So this is the way you can protect your network using security groups, and firewalls. So I think this is called network access control list or something, NACL. So we'll have to check it out what it is. I think it is called access control list. So you can define security groups and access control list. So that was a little brief on the networks. So I hope your knowledge is a little enhanced on the networks. And then we spoke about virtual server, which is nothing but your virtual machines, right? Where virtual servers are managed by hypervisors. And who is managing the hypervisor? Virtual infrastructure management software. And you can keep on moving the virtual server more easily. And hence that is, machines can be provided rapidly and on demand because we can work with virtual servers very fast. Then we spoke about cloud storage device. Cloud storage device is a storage mechanism. And we said there are four types of storage, right? One is the file storage, Second is your database storage. Third is your block storage, and fourth is your object storage. So your block storage is the most basic underlying infrastructure where it is like your hard disk, right? Which can be divided into blocks, and each block can be assigned to somebody. So we use techniques like storage area network, where all your storages are separate from your actual resources, and you can take a piece of the storage and apply on any machine. So usually we have hard disk attached to the computer, right? Everything is in one computer. But in cloud, think like all the hard disk is there in building number B, and all your computers are in building number A. Building number A does not have hard disk. Building number B has all the hard disk. Maybe 10,000 hard disk, 50,000 hard disk is in building number B. So building number A, whenever any machine needs a storage space, it has to say, I want 2 GB from building B, and then they will take a block of it and attach it using your network. And that is how even blocks can be played with, because it is not permanently attached. I can take a block and shift it and attach it to some other computer. So there is a lot of sharing and shifting happening. So I hope you understood that analogy. The storage is kept separate from the actual computing resource. So in your computer, everything is together. Definitely your computer has to have a processor. Even the memory can be separated, okay? So so there is, there's all this cloud technology where they're trying to create a very big memory, and so that they can cache a lot of data. And because if it is in the memory, it works faster, right? So that's why, they have this memcache kind of techniques where the memory is also kept separately. So computing is not, even though it works like a computer, they all work in components, and they all components are connected to each other. So there is a separate building maybe for storage, separate building for memory, separate building for your actual processors. So of course there will be some local memory also, but we are talking about like something like, if you are doing like something like big data or something, and we want a memcache kind of facility, then we have to use memory architectures. And then finally we came to cloud usage monitor, where we said we want to monitor things, right? So this is where we had reached. So when we say cloud usage monitor, means we have to monitor, right, how the cloud is performing. So we spoke about a monitoring agent. So there is a monitoring agent, which is a software. So before the cloud service consumer can access the cloud service, the monitoring agent intercepts that message and looks out for the network traffic. We look out for any network, how much traffic is coming in, what is the latency, bandwidth, throughput, etc. Then the resource agent is used for what? A resource agent is like anytime there is any one resource, it works on a resource. Okay, now network traffic is working on a network. A resource agent is a software which works on a resource. So anytime there is an event, like somebody says, somebody cloud consumer says, please create a virtual machine, the resource agent will immediately come to know that there is a request coming, an event will be fired, and resource agent will wake up. And the moment resource agent wakes up, it tries to see what is happening with the machine. The machine will go from start, it takes So the resource agent will watch out for that machine, because the machine might take 5 minutes to start up, right? It may have to create a machine, it might have to install a software, it might have to build networks, it may be a lot of a network of resource, or you're talking about one resource. But every resource, if there are 4 computers they're trying to start up, then every computer it has to see whether it has started properly, right? So initially, so it goes through different stages, right? Initiating, suspending, resuming, and vertical scaling. So vertical scaling does not happen when you create machines. So but whenever any machine is started, it goes through these phases, like initiating, suspending, and resuming. So initiating means I have started creating the machine. Suspending means please wait, you cannot do anything until I've started your machine. And resuming means the machine is already, I've set up your machine now. Now you can resume ahead. So the status will become available, right? And this resource agent will trap all these three events and keep on monitoring. Once it is in resume, it can go back to sleep. So and whenever, let's say, anyone says I want to duplicate this computer, or I want to increase the on this resource there is 2 GB, I want to make it 4 GB, I want to make 10 GB, I want to increase the storage. So little bit on vertical scaling I can explain. Okay, vertical scaling is not duplication exactly. Vertical scaling is different. So there are two types. Scaling means to grow, right? Okay, to increase or decrease. That is what scaling means. So the question is, how do we increase? No. So, so if we have a storage, let's say we have 2 GB of storage, I can say I want to increase it to 4 GB. This is one type of scaling. I'm scaling what? I'm scaling storage. The other thing is like a duplication kind of storage, right? Where I'm saying I have one machine and I want to add, you know, 4 machines. I want to duplicate 4 machines. So this is, what are you scaling? Scaling, you auto, scaling machines, right? But there's a difference in the two types of scaling. In this scaling, in the first type of scaling, there is a machine, then there is a storage attached to it, right? You given 2 GB over here, 2 GB over here, and that same resource you are now increasing the height. It is like increasing the flows of the inside the building, only you're adding something more, right? So you have added, now this has become another 2 GB, then total it became 4 GB, right? So you are increasing your storage. It is not you know, there's no parallel resource been created, you know. It's a this kind of scaling which is going upwards is called vertical scaling. This is working on how many resource? One resource. So, and who is going to wake up in case if you touch the resource? Who's going to wake up? The resource agent is going to wake up. An event is going to be fired, and he is going to see whether 2 GB is been initiated, suspended, and resumed. Means when it all the things, all the operations of attaching the another 2 GB is finished. So let us attach. Initially only this is attached. Then you made a request. Then it goes in the initiating phase. Then slowly. The storage request will go to the other building, right, where the storage is, and they'll say I want a block of 2 GB data now. So that block also has to be attached to this block, and then once it is done, it will get in the resume state. So resource agent is doing the same thing of checking whether it is initiated, suspended, or resumed. So but it is looking for what? Vertical scaling, which works on one resource. So this is called vertical scaling. So what is there? Definitely you will understand now what is the other one. Other one is horizontal scaling. So why it is horizontal scaling? Because you have one machine over here, right? And then you said I want to scale my machine, means to 4 more computers. So there's another resource, and there's fourth resource. So how many resource agents will wake up because of this? That's a question. Okay, this is a horizontal scaling where you're increasing left to, you know, it's moving left and right, increasing sideways. It is like you have one building, but you're not increasing the floor, but you're increasing the number of buildings. Okay, that is a horizontal scaling. And in the one where you're increasing the number of floors in the same building, it is called vertical scaling. So tell me how many resource, because this machine was already there, okay? Now somebody, you got a request that you want to add machine number 2, so let's give a different color. You want to add this machine 2, which is same like 1. You want to add machine number 3, which is same like 1. And we'll add machine number 4, which is same like 1. How many resource agents will be working on this? Question. Can anyone tell how many resource agents will be working on this? So in this, this is this one resource agent working on this one resource. Resource means your compute, you know, your computer, your storage. So any answers? So there will be one resource agent for this fellow. Every resource will have its own resource agent, right? So you're going to spawn one same program again. So the program is same, but multiple copies of that program will be looking out for that resource, whether you have started or not, right? So this resource agent wakes up and he has to see that this machine has moved from start state, initiate state to resume state, right? And then this fellow watches out for this. And the data for 4, 2 and 3, where it is logged, all of this is logged in a database. So every time the machine moves from initiate phase, so initially, as I told you, initiate, suspend, and resume state. So there will be 3 entries every time. First time it will, this resource agent will log that the machine has initiated. When entry will go over here in the database, it will have its own internal database. Let us assume this is a database. So there will be an entry. What will be the entry? The entry will be 3 initiated. Then let's say just when 3 was initiated, 2 was initiated. Then let's say when 2 was initiated, 3 went into suspend state. Then let's say 4 initiated. So these are all logs, you know, which gives you an idea, and they will have a timeline, time stamp also. They will say this happened at 10 o'clock p.m. in the night on so and so date. So this is a log been created. The second fellow will say 2 initiated at 10.00.05 second. So because it is very fast, right? So we are dealing with nanoseconds actually. So every second is counted in detail. So this will be like say 01:01 p.m. Then point, let's say 01:15 p.m. So this fellow resource agents for each resource will not stop actively monitoring the resource till what? Till it will keep on logging till 2 resume is not logged, 3 resume is not logged, and 4 resume is not logged. So this resource agent is intelligent, okay? Because it will know that this machine is supposed to start in, let's say, 5 seconds from initiate to resume, or 5 minutes. You give the timeline. If it does not start and if it does not go in resume, then it will inform some other program. Whom it can inform? Resource agent. It will inform some other program in case of errors or in case of the machine not starting. Inform status, success or failure, you know, whatever status. So the question is whom it can inform. That's the question. Any answers? Machines, virtual machine is managed by whom? Virtual machines are managed by whom? Which piece of software manages virtual machine? Anyone? Virtual machines are managed by hypervisors, right? So there may be one or more hypervisor. The machine number 4 and 2 may be managed by hypervisor 1. Machine number 3 may be managing by hypervisor 3. So if there are some issues at hypervisor level, which hypervisor can control only the machine on one physical machine, okay? But if there are three, if the machines are created on different physical machines, they have to be managed by which software? Hypervisors are managed by which software? That's another question. Machines are managed by hypervisors, and hypervisors are on different physical machine and managed by whom? Answer is virtual infrastructure management software. So there are many components involved in the cloud, right? One is a virtual machine. Then we are doing vertical scaling and horizontal scaling, and every resource has been tracked by whom? By a resource agent for vertical scaling, not for horizontal scaling. In case of horizontal scaling, every resource will be monitored by separate resource agent software, and whenever as the machine moves from initiate state to suspend to resume, it will keep on logging in a log database over here, and so that anytime anybody wants to investigate what went wrong, they look at the log database. You know that it moved from initiated state, but there was no log for resume, means it never resumed itself. And in case if there is once this apart from this logging, it kind of triggers an information, somebody else to take action. And who is that who can take action is hypervisor can take action if the machine has been created on its own physical machine. If the machine is created somewhere else, that other hypervisor will take. And if hypervisor is not able to manage, if there is if 4 and 2 are connected to each other but they are different physical machine, that means hypervisors are also different. And in that we have to go to a head, like virtual infrastructure manager is like a top manager, then hypervisor is like a little manager, and then internally you have all these employees kind of stuff. So it is kind of a hierarchy, who is managing whom. Okay, so the third type of agent is the polling agent. The polling agent monitors the, so polling agent is also like a software. So what does the polling agent do? The polling agent monitors the status of cloud service hosted by virtual server by sending periodic polling request messages and receiving polling request messages that the report usage status A after the number of polling cycles until it receives a usage status of B, upon which the polling agent will record the new usage status in the log database. So we had monitoring agent, okay? So let me just save this file. So there are three types of agent, right? One which is used to monitor, monitoring agent. This will monitor what? Network traffic. And then we have resource agent. This will monitor what? Resources when the event is fired. So they are sleeping all the time and they will never be awake. Polling agent is monitor resources. So what does it monitor resources? It monitors resources for for the machine states, right? And it wakes up only when the machine request is coming. Machine states or storage states, something like that. Storage states means 2 GB to 4 GB. This fellow polling agent is it doesn't require to be, you know, it never sleeps actually. So it is always awake, which means it is always running. And what it does is it tries to see whether this machine is running or not running. That is all that it has to do. Is this machine on or is this off? Or you can say in other words, is this machine up or is this machine down? So how does it work? So there will be a polling agent software over here. So this is your polling agent. So this fellow, as I said, is always running. So this fellow, every five seconds, it will ping the computer. If the response comes back, I hope you all know what is ping. Let's see, ping www.google.com. So you see, I get a reply, means google.com is awake. But let me see, ping www. Let's say I had a website Google, 1/4 this. Now I know there is no website like this, right? Will I get a response? Ping request, could not find something, which means this website is either not existing or either it is down. Okay. If google.com was down, we wouldn't have got this reply. And that is what this ping fell, this polling agent is doing. This polling agent is sending a simple ping command. Let me give a different. Every 5 seconds, it is sending a ping request that whether, okay, you know, I'm pinging you, please get me a response. If it gets a response, what does it mean? If it gets a response, it means it is up. Okay, so this is one scenario. What is other scenario? The other scenario, I'm pinging you, but you said it is down. So I'm pinging you every 5 seconds, right? So in this one, in this particular time when I pinged you, you said you did not respond. So I will try one more time. I will have some rule. You know, the polling agent will have his own logic, right? That I will try at least 3 times in 15 seconds, every 5 seconds, right? So this time also I poll. What is the message I'm getting? This time also there is no response. The machine is still saying it is down. I am always awake. So I will poll the next, after 5 seconds, I will poll again. And again, I did not get the response. So I am assuming this is down. Now 3 times down means I can assume that that machine is totally down, and I can go and log. I can inform the, put this entry in the log database over here. So your log database, I will put an entry, machine is down at 10 PM. Once it goes in the database, if a message of down goes, something else will trigger, right? Somebody else has to operate on this. So it can be whom it can be? It can be hypervisor. And if hypervisor is not able to manage, who will manage? Hypervisor in turn can give the request to VIM, Virtual Infrastructure Management. Virtual Infrastructure Management manages one or more hypervisors. Hypervisor manages machines. So if machine is down, the polling agent will inform the hypervisor, and that is how everything is coordinated inside the cloud, because there are so many customers and so many machines running, all these agents have to be utilized, and these are the mechanisms: monitoring agent, resource agent, polling agent. In this, the first two, they are always sleeping. They wake up only when there is a particular event. Somebody wakes them up, you know, that this is what is happening. And in the last case, this fellow, it doesn't require an event. He is always awake. He keeps on polling everyone in the network. So there are a lot of polling agents. Okay, so you can write a simple program also, right? Polling agent send ping to any machine and see whether you get a reply. If you don't get a reply in 5 seconds, you try again. And if you again don't get a reply, then maybe you can log in a database. This, so polling agent is a simple software, but it works on a very high scale on many machines. And so you can have multiple polling agents mean trying to poll different machines, so in different subnets, right? So there are a lot of networks and right, a lot of VPCs and a lot of subnets. So every subnet, you know, one subnet may be having most likely one or two polling agents. So what is this mechanism? What does it come under? Cloud usage monitor mechanism. This is how we monitor in cloud. So I hope you all understood this. So if there is a resource, and if there are three agents working on this resource, for example, let's say monitoring agent is like working on a network actually, and what is the other one? Polling. In the first case, the request comes in this direction. This is your step number one, always. And in resource agent also, it comes, the resource agent, the message comes here. An event has to be fired. This is also step number one, right? But in polling, what happens? It doesn't wait for the resource, it polls. It's a reverse direction. Okay, these are the first steps. So what is the difference between resource agent and polling agent? Resource agent is event based, where it has to be, you know, woken up to monitor the resource for its different machine states or vertical scaling. Polling agent is a very simple responsibility, just to verify whether things are up or down. It is up or down, so it manages machines, databases, it can be anything actually. Monitoring agent, monitoring agent looks after network traffic. Resource agent looks after machine states and vertical scaling. So you know what vertical scaling is now. And polling agent looks after machine up or down state, but it uses a polling technique. So difference between the resource agent and the polling agent is the direction of request and response. So that I hope you all have understood. In resource agent mechanism, the resource agent is sent to the resource agent by software. Hypervisor or VIM sends info about virtual server. So what it says is the machine is not directly sending the status of the machine. It is the hypervisor who is also. So one is that the hypervisor can be informed and for any issues, but at the same time hypervisor is also sending the status back to the agents. So in polling agent mechanism, the polling agent polls the resource for the status change. Initially it receives the status A while the polling continues, the status changes to B and then the polling agent records a change in status. Example, virtual machine has moved from pending to starting state to started. There is a one-time event notification in case of resource agent. There is a continuous polling in case of polling agent. So the fifth type of resource is resource replication. Fifth type of mechanism, cloud computing mechanisms. So we'll take maybe we'll take a 25 minutes break now, and we'll start at 4 p.m. Okay. Hello. Yeah, Suresh. Yeah, Suresh. Hold on, huh? 1 minute, huh? Suresh. I'm just. Hold on, huh? Suresh, my class is going on, huh? I'm just. Okay. So the next mechanism is the fifth mechanism in infrastructure, where we are multiplying resources, which means we are creating duplicate copies of the machine. So in one machine there is a Ubuntu, there would be another machine in the Ubuntu. So now here you see there are four physical servers. These are actual machines, okay, on which the hypervisor is managing all the hypervisor on these machines, or I'm not sure if it's a separate piece of software which is managing, but I would assume that there's one hypervisor on one machine. Okay, so it may be the same hypervisor like VirtualBox running on each machine. Now the thing is, but here we are talking at a very high level that hypervisors are on one side, there are physical servers, and I told you, right, the cloud storage device is where it is a separate storage facility, right? So this is like many storages in one network. It is looking like one box, but this may be very big, like one building of entire storage area network. And you take a piece of this storage and you attach it to the machines over here. On the left hand side, what you're seeing is a virtual machines created. So out of four physical machines, how many virtual machines you have created? Three. So it depends on how big the virtual machines is. So resource replication can be thought of as a multiplying the existing infrastructure such as virtual machines. So what are we picking up? From here it says it is picking up what? It is picking up a virtual server image. So virtual server image is nothing but your virtual machine file, right? So you have created, you created a virtual machine first, you installed Ubuntu and then you saved it as a file. So that file is called virtual server image. So anytime if anybody now wants Ubuntu, you just take this file and you tell the hypervisor to create an instance of that virtual server, and then your Ubuntu will start with that operating system. That is what we did in the demo also, right? We created a platform, and then that platform it was stored as a virtual machine image which can be used anywhere and transferred to anyone else too for reusing it. Using this one image, you can create as many machines as you want, right? So here using one image, they're creating three machines. Resource replication is defined as a creation of multiple instances of the same IT resource. Replication is typically performed when an IT resource availability or performance needs to be enhanced, right? So when why would you want to multiply the resource? Number one is if one machine goes down, then the second machine will be available, right? As a backup strategy. The third is also performance, right? Maybe I'm not using as a backup. Maybe I'm using a backup strategy, but also I want to run things in parallel. So if I'm if I want to do parallel computing, we have done parallel computing in semester 3, right? So if I want to do parallel computing, I can create as many machines as I want, and I can distribute my load between all these machines, and that way the my response time will be much faster, right? In case if I'm sharing the load among all the virtual machines using parallel computing, and that way I can increase my performance. So what is availability? Availability is a backup strategy, right? It is making sure that if active server goes down, the passive server becomes active again. So you can have that is an active passive configuration, right? If you have an active configuration, means both the servers are of the same type and they're up all the time. So which means you can do parallel computing also in such cases. So resource replication, the hypervisor replicates several instances of virtual server using stored virtual server image, and that is what we seen. This is a virtual server image which has been picked up, and we create a virtual machine which is a piece of this physical machine. Such replication is independent of the location where the resources needs to be located. So looking at this at a broader level, like you can think of physical, so in AWS there are a lot of data centers, and in each data center there are a lot of physical servers, right? And where are these data centers? These data centers are all over the world. So some part of the world, in India there will be two, in Mumbai region there will be few buildings of all these servers, and then another region will be, let's say, Australia, another region Japan, another region Africa, another region America, right? In all these regions, all these physical servers will be available. So now if I want to create a virtual server image, does the location matter? It depends on where I need the machine, right? Virtual machine. So I will try to use the data center which is closer to the location, and based on that need only I will create the virtual machine there, so that it is so that we can, our networks can be faster, right? If the server is very close to you, if I created a virtual machine which is in Mumbai server, that response time will be much faster compared to a server created in America, because it takes time to travel from America to India. So there will be a latency. So we have already spoken about bandwidth, latency and throughput, right? What's the difference? So in case of resource failure, the resource can be replicated anywhere, right? So because you cannot create new physical machines, right? You cannot, like, if you have one laptop, you cannot say I will have two laptops, right? That is, physically you cannot multiply. But if you are having a software piece which simulates a physical machine, you can create as many copies as you want and anywhere that you want. So we come to our last infrastructure mechanism, which is ready-made environment. Your ready-made environment is nothing but platform as a service. In last year, semester 3, we did a demo where we created a platform, right? It was a ready-made environment. And this is the ready-made environment is also one of the mechanism to provide. Hold on. A ready-made environment is always good, right? So let's say I want to do a robotics application. So a ready-made environment is available inside the cloud where you can use RoboMaker, right? On AWS there's a software called RoboMaker. So when you use RoboMaker, you don't have to install robotics operating system, you don't have to install anything, right? It's all ready-made environment, and that makes life so easy. If you have to set up this robotics environment on your local box, it would have taken a lot of time, and you have to resolve so many issues of the installation, configuration. It may work, it may not work. Even before you write your first program, all this installation has to work. So ReadyMade, in order to make sure that the cloud consumers can be serviced better, ReadyMade environment is one of the infrastructure mechanism is given, where the ReadyMade environment is not flat, not only the platform but the underlying infrastructure. So let me, I can explain this a little bit. So what does, so last year what did we, what kind of ready-made environment we did? We created, we had a virtual box, right? So we had a virtual box and we went in and we created a virtual machine inside this, right? So we said this virtual machine. And what all we installed on this machine? We installed Ubuntu, Maven, and Java. And all this was all packed in one file, right? So there was a file, myplatform.vdi or something. So this is nothing but your virtual server image or virtual machine image or virtual instance. Now I can take this file anywhere and give it to anyone. And that is a platform, right, which I can transfer over here. So this is a very simple simple ready-made environment, right? So this is a simple ready-made environment. So what can be complex then? So the second scenario that is possible is I have two images, let's say. So I have so I let's say I have a very big machine. Inside this I create two virtual machine 1, virtual machine 2. So let me say this is VM 1 and this is VM 2. Maybe my VM is a web server platform where websites can be executed, where my website can be executed. And this can be your database platform, right, where your databases are installed. So on this box I will provide Oracle service, maybe, or maybe or SQL service, okay. So in this box I may say I am having Apache web server plus Java. And this machine is connected to this machine at all the time, so that for any database operation, because a website may be dynamic, right, where you have data that needs to be created, updated, deleted. So we require a database access, but it is in a separate image. So whenever it has to access, it has to be in a particular network. So this may be a part of your subnet. Right, we already spoke about a subnet. It may be part of one subnet, or maybe this is in the private subnet, and this can be inside your public subnet. You can create this machine in a public subnet, and you need to connect to each other. So, if you have to connect to each other, then you need to know the IP address. So, this fellow may be having 0.1.0 based on the subnet IP addresses, that is CIDR addresses that is allocated to. In this, the machine may be having something like this, right, depending on the CIDR for the public subnet. So the access will be given to the web server, and the web server will be given access to the database layer, which is in the private subnet. Now if you have to create this kind of platform, this is a combination of two virtual machines, right? Not one virtual machine. It is a combination of two virtual machines. So whenever I say two virtual machines, it can also be a container-based technology. So then I will have two containers, right? And they have to be networked. So IP addresses have to be configured. So so maybe there are two different pieces, but these two different pieces doesn't make sense, right? Logically, they are connected as an application. You know, they are logically, they are one application. A database, it doesn't make sense without the web server doesn't make sense, you know, without the database. So even there are two different pieces. So if I want to create a ready-made environment, I want to create this logical, application made up of two machines, right? Two machines connected via a network parameters, right? If you're giving, you will not be only giving website, right? It will be the website has to operate, then it has to have the dynamic data coming from the Oracle database. So both the pieces have to not, so whenever you add, so how many images will be there? First of all, this will be my database platform, let's say .vdi. So this and this will be my web server platform .vdi. If you want to give this platform to anybody to develop their websites and with a database support, you have to give both the VDIs. These VDIs files are two separate. So so this kind of ready-made environments also they are little complex, where there are many more virtual machines included, many more resources included. So ready-made environment does not mean only one type of resources there or only one resources there. It may be a combination of many resources, and you have to give all the resources as one logical unit. Okay. So when you're buying a house, you want a, you don't get bedroom separately, you don't buy bedroom separately and hall separately, right? You get it as a logical unit, even though two different units, subunits. So having understood this, so in cloud, what all services are available to create this kind of complex, complex logical units? So if you go to AWS, there is a service called CloudFormation. In this CloudFormation, you can specify the resources and how these resources are connected to each other. So all this will be specified in some simple template file in the form of JSON. So it may look something like this. So a CloudFormation template file may look something like a JSON. So it will say I have a resource, and then this resource, maybe it has a type, it is a web server, and the file name is my web server .vdi. It can be something like this, right? So let's say I put a bracket, okay, just to separate it out. So this is one resource, and let me put it in blue color. And then I will, in the same file, I will say there is another resource, and I'll say the ID of this Oops, what happened? Everything lost. Okay. So JSON file, I hope you understand now JSON file looks like. It is very structured like a tree. So I have a resource, and this resource I can define the type of resource, right? What is type equal to, right? My web server. And I can give the image file name, right? Image file is, you can give a path over here, whatever path you want to give it, maybe a URL link or whatever. My web server.vdi. Right, and then you can define another resource also, right? And sorry, I missed that is where you need to give a ID to the resource, right? This is ID equal to 1. So this is like a database only, simple text file. This is also resource, and I will say ID is equal to 2, simple database row entries. What is the type? Type will be my database server. And image will be dot dot slash my database server dot vdi. Apart from this, I need to define probably network entries, right? Network entry. So network, first network I will say, I may have a subnet. Inside this subnet, I may have, so this is not exact words that I'm using, but this is just an analogy. Okay, how to create a cloud formation template, it looks, will it look something similar. So in this subnet I will create I will mention the CIDR range. If this will be 10.0.1.0/22, and then in this I will say I want to create resource 1, ID is equal to 1, let's say. What happened? Again it went. So anyway, I'm going to just now you know what resource contains, right? Resource 1 is over here. You describe your resource 1, then you describe your resource 2 inside this, right? And in the same file you continue with network description. In this network you can say I have a subnet 1, and in this subnet 1 what it is a type of public, right? Type equal to public. The moment you say public, an internet gateway is going to get created. And then you will say CIDR range. You may say this is in this this network is a CIDR range of 10.0.0.1/2 bits, right? That we 2 bits will contain for maximum 4 computers. And in this I may have a resource created which is 1, and you know already what 1 is, right? Your 1 is your web server. So 1 comma web server, you can say, and 2 comma Oracle database. Now that one subnet is created, you can have another subnet right over here in the same way, but in this case this subnet will be what? The type will be private. And what will be the CIDR? CIDR will be 10.0.1.0/3 bits. So more computers, more the number of bits, more computers can be created in this, more IP addresses will get. So type is private, CIDR is this, and resource is equal to 2. It is a private network. Then, apart from this, what all we have to define? We have to connect the two subnets also, no? So the file will continue down. So I'm just typing in the side. It may say network. Let's say connect. I may define some routes, you know, so that is one way you can do, right? Routes, you can define route table. In this route table, what you will say? Any entry that comes from 0.0.1/2, you know, if database request come, they can access 0.0.1.03. So this is a rule, right? That if a request is this is your request is coming from source, this and this is your target, you know, this is where the request can go in. So you're defining that route. If you define this route, you're giving access from public subnet to private subnet. So this is just one example where this kind of templates are called cloud formation templates. So whenever you want to install a very complex kind of a ready-made environment, you can use this kind of cloud formation templates. So as such, there are a lot of ready-made environments to create all types of applications on cloud, right? You can create a robotics application, as I told you. You can create a virtual reality application. You don't have to install anything, right? You simply start writing a program. You may have your Java platform, Python platform, all languages, whatever languages you want. You can even write a simple programs. So there is a platform for everything. You can create a blockchain application, right? And you can create your database applications, everything. Where there's a ready-made platform for everything, and every platform is created using some kind of a template. And it is a template or class, a template like cloud formation template could be used to create a complex ready-made environment. So I hope you got an idea of what AWS cloud formation is. So apart from AWS cloud formation, there is another the complexity can be beyond, right? Maybe this time the complexity is that you want to create a platform, a complex platform in Africa, right? You want to create a complex ready-made environment. You want this environment to be installed over here in Africa. And so this is one environment. And maybe the other environment is in AWS. So this is your AWS. So AWS is like a cloud. So you want to create another environment over here, and this is created in, let's say, Mumbai region. So this is your private private office, okay, where you want to install in your office some piece of softwares, there's a complex environment which contains two or three subnets and four of a lot of resources in each of these subnets, and this is like all connected, right? Let's say, and in the cloud at the same time you have another let's say assume this is AWS cloud. You have another complex environment where you have lot of pieces have to be installed over here also. So these are also connected. Now, apart from this, you also need to connect, this environment is connected to this environment. Okay, so this fellow and this fellow are connected to each other. Like there is a database over here, let's say, and there is a web server here. This database is connected to this web server. This fellow is connected to this server. So you can get, let me use a different color. So basically, resources, this is like a hybrid architecture, right? Where something is in the private office and something is there in the public cloud. So in this case of ready-made environment, what is your approach going to be? So one approach is you create one CloudFormation template over here, and this will create an environment in AWS. And you can so this is template number one, right? Which you describe the resource, and then you create another CloudFormation template over here, which is number two, which has the resources as per the environment that is required in your private office. But the thing is, even though this is one logical unit in the private office, and even though this is a one logical unit in the cloud, public cloud, both these CloudFormation templates are also a one logical unit. So this can be seen as one application, even though they are spread across different locations. So this complexity has increased now suddenly. So this is the environment you have to create. So the question is how? So you can look at softwares like Ansible, Terraform, etc., etc., etc. Ansible and Terraform. The advantage of Terraform is it can connect to different types of clouds. So if you have one environment in AWS to be created and one environment in Azure, and both of them are logically connected to each other, then you can use Terraform. And Ansible is one of the popular, popular software also that is come up in the market. And the idea behind Ansible and Terraform is managing, creating complex environments, especially in a hybrid environment. So I hope you understand what hybrid means now: private office and your public cloud. So private cloud and public cloud mix. So ready-made environment is not as simple as only creating one machine. It can be one machine, it can be a set of machines, it can be machines in two different multiple networks, it can be a combination of different environments across in different locations and different clouds also. Same. So the ready-made environment mechanism is a defining component of the platform as a service cloud delivery model that represents a predefined cloud-based platform comprised a set of already installed IT resources ready to be used and customized by the cloud consumer. These environments are utilized by cloud consumers to remotely develop and deploy their own services and applications within a cloud. Typically, ready-made environments include pre-installed IT resources such as databases, middleware, development tools, and governance tools. A ready-made environment is generally equipped with complete software development kit that provides cloud consumers with programmatic access and to the development technology, and that comprise a preferred programming stack. So with that, so whenever you have to write about cloud infrastructure mechanism, remember this six mechanisms. So as I told you, your unit two consists of cloud infrastructure mechanism, specialized cloud mechanism, and cloud management mechanism. So you have kind of finished 30% of unit two, you can say.